The other day, I got to go to dinner at a house and not too far away from here. And the dear couple's expecting a baby. They already have a son and three little daughters, two daughters and two sons. And when I was pulling up, I could see all the kids in the window. They're all like, oh, here's Father Jay. You know, it's so cool to see them all staring there. And then as I approached, there was like, you know, the mailbox, the old mailbox that have like a little slit in the wall. And so one of the little girls had like pushed it open and I could see her eyes, you know. And then when I knocked on the door, all of a sudden it went boom. And I heard these like little girl like running and they opened up the door and she had run up the steps. And so she was up there hiding and the rest are all down there greeting me. And yeah, what a blessing it is, right, to be able to, walk into somebody's house like that and feel so well received. And you know, today is we're kind of maybe, I don't know what your Super Bowl plans are. Maybe we're going to walk into somebody's house and be there to hopefully watch Tom Brady lose. But the thing is that when I was growing up, I was always used to the Steelers being in the Super Bowl. So it's like part of Super Bowl Sunday. And now we should be used to Brady always being there. Maybe we should be calling this the Brady Bowl, you know? I hope not. But what we hear in the gospel today, the reference to Peter's mother-in-law, how can we not think of all those just awful, you know, those jokes? They're always the butt end of jokes. You ever notice that? Even there's a Budweiser Super Bowl commercial where this guy calls his buddy and says, yeah, my girlfriend's coming over to watch the Super Bowl and she's bringing her mom. And the guy on the other side of the phone says, oh, well, make sure you look at that mother because that's what your girlfriend's going to look like in 30 years. You know, it's just terrible. It's like, what do you need to say that, right? Or, you know, that joke that some of these preachers sometimes say, you know, priests and stuff, you know, they're talking about Peter. You know, why did Peter deny Jesus three times? Because he cured his mother-in-law. Just awful. These are just such tasteless jokes. So just not good, you know? Because in the Bible, one of the greatest mother-in-laws is Naomi. Yeah, she's just amazing mother-in-law. And then from there comes Obed, and just all these great things. And then, you know, so it's just awful. Or, you know, that other joke that sometimes you hear preachers talk about, it's like, why were Adam and Eve the happiest couple ever? Because they didn't have mother-in-laws. You know, just awful, tasteless jokes, right? But Jesus enters right into those tough relationships. You know, maybe there's some relationships in our own lives that were just like, yikes. And when Jesus hears about his mother-in-law being sick, you know, they lived right near the water, and so malaria was so common, and this fever was sudden, and it was going to probably end in her death, and so Peter, you know, begs Jesus to come into his home and go into that relationship that's so challenging. And he gets there and he cures his mother-in-law. And I don't know, it's so beautiful to think about like allowing Jesus to come into those relationships that are challenging for us. Perhaps it's a friend, maybe it's a spouse, maybe it's a daughter, a son-in-law. Maybe it's a mother-in-law. Maybe it's a friend at school that you just don't like seeing and you're glad that you're quarantined from them now. There are all these relationships that need Jesus to come into to cure. Because many times it's beyond our control. You know, when I was able to bless this house, which was so cool, I don't know if this happens to you. Well, maybe it doesn't because you've never gone in to bless a house like I have. But Mom was like, because the dad's like, yeah, let's go bless the house. And Mom's like, no, not that room. You know that room? Yeah, it's like pretty dirty. It hasn't been vacuumed in a long time or whatever, you know? Yeah, that's the room we need Jesus to go in and enter. It's like, yeah, there could be relationships, but what about in our own hearts? Do we have these rooms that, like, Jesus doesn't even get into that room? That's like the dark desires. Those are the things that I've done that I don't want anybody to know about. Those are the areas where I go to and nobody's allowed in. Those closets, those places that are all locked up. You know that famous English painting, right? I think it's at St. Paul's, a Protestant cathedral in London, right? Where Jesus is out in front of a cottage and he's knocking on the door. He's got the lantern and you can tell there's weeds out there. In other words, Jesus has been there a long time. And there is no door handle on the outside. And he's not going to bust the door in. He respects our freedom. He respects the fact that we could slam the door in his face and he's never going to leave. He's always going to be there. waiting for us to open up the door to those places where no one else is allowed in, because it's too dirty, it's too dark, it's too difficult, it's too dastardly. That's the room where Jesus wants to go. If you've ever been to Capernaum in the Holy Land, you can actually go to the exact spot that's talked about in the gospel today. All these little rooms made of these beautiful rocks, and on top is now a church. And yeah, go to that room with Jesus. Like, bring them, drag them through your house, every room in your house, all the different rooms and crevices in your life. And it's so incredible. Like, Peter understood this. It's like, in this Gospel of Mark, which I hope that you'll pick up and read as soon as you possibly can, there's so many urgent messages that God has there. It's like that annoying Twitter feed that keeps sending out this news that you, like, you have to know that this actress just changed their socks. And if you don't know that, then your life is just a failure. But this is like real stuff, because there's nobody who knows you better than Jesus. And there's nobody who wants to enter into those parts of your home like Jesus does. It's so how urgent it is for us to be like Peter. We're only just a couple verses into the Gospel of Mark. He's already cured people. He's exorcising demons. He's been preaching on Peter's boat. And isn't that neat? It's like Jesus gets onto Peter's boat to preach. And now today, he does his first cure, his miracle of curing, where? In Peter's home. What was Peter's boat but his place of work? Have we invited Jesus to our work? Now, maybe we're quarantined, so work and home are the same. But maybe that our careers, our big job things, or these challenges, or the business plan that we're doing, or the board meeting, or whatever it is that we're doing, our careers, have we allowed Jesus to stand by our side and truly speak into that? And to our colleagues, our coworkers, and for those who are in school, when was the last time we let Jesus carry those books with us? I don't know, do they even have books today? Do they carry books? I don't know, whatever it is that you're studying. Like, how awesome would it be when you open up your studies to first just say, come Holy Spirit, because I don't understand a darn thing that's going on right now. Like, send me your wisdom. Those of you who've been confirmed, you have all these intellectual gifts that God's given you. It's like, yeah, right there. And then in your home, it's so amazing. Jesus goes to his workplace and to his home. And isn't it interesting that we didn't have enough ink in the bulletin today? Did you notice that? It's where we're trying to save money, you know? At least that's my interpretation. But at any rate, it says here, it's so beautiful. Jesus just crushing demons, just going after everything. It's just great. Because the whole town was gathered around the door of Peter's house, cured many who were sick of various diseases. And then listen to this. Jesus drove out many demons, not permitting the demons to speak, because the demons knew the Son of God. The demons pre-existed the birth of Jesus. Jesus, from all eternity, existed obviously as the Son of God. And these demons were created before humanity was created. You imagine the amount of experience and the intelligence of the angels, which pre-exist us. They pre-exist Jesus' birth. So you know what? They know exactly how to slowly lead us away from the things of Jesus. They're just so good at it. I mean, we get so excited about things that just take us just off the path. You ever think of your life like, how many times we go to confession and we say the same things? You know, the devil has these patterns in which he works and works and works and works and works. Why? Because they've been doing this for a long time. Well before any of us ever existed, even before Jesus was born. And so the intelligence of the demons, they're really good at this. So many times we do have to be kind of like those quarterbacks that can look at the play and be able to say, okay, this is not working. I need to audibleize. And especially those of you who are dads and moms who are heads of your household, the demons love to destroy marriage. That's like their favorite thing to do, because if they knock that down, then they get to the kids. And so it's so incredible to see so many who fight for their marriages, so many of you who fight for your children, so many who recognize that what your houses truly need are to be blessed and have Jesus come into it. And you know, as I was going around this house, the little girl who hid up in the stairs, we were going around doing the blessing, and it was really fun because I got this up. It's called, I guess it's like chalk. It's like chalk that you use on sidewalks. I don't know what it's called, but it was really good. And it's blue, so then I could write on the walls. And she thought, this is the greatest thing ever. And so I did, you know the Epiphany blessing where you put 20 and then the cross, and you put Christus Mansionem Benedicta 21. And or it could be Caspar, Belfasar, and Melchor, the three kings. Maybe I was doing that on the doorways, and she thought this was the greatest thing. She's joining me in this. And it was her room, was the room that nobody wanted to go into. And she was like, yeah, come on in. And at the end, as I was just sitting on the couch there, you know, mom was sitting there, dad was over there. Mom's pregnant, so she doesn't have a lot of space to be like snuggling up. At least that's what I thought. One of the little girls, I don't know how she did this, she got in behind mom, behind the chair, and her head stuck out here, and her feet and stuff were like behind mom. And then the other little girl came up on top of mom the other way. And so there she was holding her three little girls all snuggled up together. And the two of them just fell asleep. It was so beautiful to just see the way they would just naturally cuddle up and be warm around mom. Did you notice the part that actually wasn't in the Evangelium, but at the end of the scripture here? It says, Jesus got up early in the morning to a place that was silent to pray. If we take one thing away from today's Mass, hopefully we can allow ourselves to snuggle up with the Lord, to truly find that place every day, to just be silent and rest in Him, and to allow Him to warm the coldest spots of our heart. Because as Job says, life is a drudgery. And Jesus wants to be there in that, to cuddle up with us.